So on this last day of class, we are going to be considering Ajax, which is a mechanism that allows JavaScript to communicate with a server and incrementally refresh or update a web page without losing all the state information associated with the JavaScript program, which is what typically happens if the server sends back a completely new page. Before we do that, a couple reminders. First of all, the exam is this Friday I believe it's 12:45 to 2:45. Before I get that incorrect, let's make sure. So indeed, nope, it is, wait, there it is. It is 12:30 to 2:30. So the final is 2:30. Really not doing well. 12:30 to 2:30 this Friday. And I have published a previous sample final. However, the final won't completely be like this because this one has more essay questions on it than I'm able to actually grade. So it's going to be a bit more multiple choice heavy than this, but it certainly gives you a good idea of what I might ask for you to do in terms of writing Perl regular expressions, solving a B-tree, and the fill-in-the-blank questions could very well be similar to what's on the exam. It's just questions two, three, and four would not be in the form of essay questions. They'd be in the form of multiple choice questions. Also, you should review the quizzes. The quizzes are an excellent practice for the final because a lot of the same kinds of questions that I ask on the quizzes could easily appear on the final. I've even taken questions off of quizzes before and put them on the final. Also remember that the homework assignment, the final homework assignment, is due this evening. And it is due, there's no late submissions. So it's due today at 5 p.m. The reason no late submissions is so that I can post the solutions so that you have something to study going into the exam on Friday. And apparently, some of you had never discovered where the solutions were posted. They are on the Blackboard site. And there is a link called Homework Solutions. And if you go there, there they are. So you can download and have a look at them. Okay, so any questions or concerns? Very good. So remember that there will be a B-tree problem on the final. Okay, other than that, the final will only cover scripting languages. So scripting languages plus B-trees. There won't be database stuff on it except for the MySQL I stuff that allows you to communicate between PHP and SQL. But otherwise, you don't have to remember your relational theory or how to create those SQL queries or how to do ER notation or stuff like that. Okay, so I said, today, talking about Ajax, and you can see here, this is the definition for it. It allows JavaScript to communicate asynchronously with a server and update a page without having to reload it. So there's a couple things here. First of all, what does asynchronously mean? What it means is that the user can continue to interact with the browser while the server works on the request. So the user can continue to interact with the browser. While server processes requests. Traditionally, what would happen is if you submit, say, form data to the server, and the server did some processing on it, and let's say it served back a completely new page, that's called synchronous processing. And what happens is that while the server is serving the page back to the browser is frozen. It's not completely frozen. You could click the button in the browser up here to stop it. Okay, often when you see loading, you know there's an X that appears. So you could click the X and that would stop it. But short of that, you're stuck while the server returns a page to you. Whereas with AJAX, the request is sent to the server and you continue to interact with the browser, entering form information or moving stuff up and down. And in addition to that, you could fork yet another AJAX request while the other one is outstanding, and the server will go to work on that one as well. So you can have multiple AJAX requests outstanding at the same time. The server will be working independently on each one. For each one, there will be a script running. As the requests are completed, possibly out of order, there will be a function called on the back end, on the JavaScript side, to process the results and to update the web page, which I will show you in a moment. Okay. So AJAX stands for Asynchronous JavaScript and XML. The reason XML is that originally AJAX requests, the way that they were answered was with an XML document from the server. It's also possible to send back plain text from the server and have the client side parse it. But the advantage of sending XML back was that there were these DOM parsers, just like PHP has DOM parsers, JavaScript has them as well, that parse the XML document and then allow you to interact with it and extract the data. Now, more recently, there's been another so-called interchange format established for communications between the server and the client. Does anyone know what that more recent interchange standard is? JSON. So these days, you would probably be as likely or more likely to send data back to the client in a JSON encoded format, and then on the client side, there is a decoding command that will decode that JSON and put the key value pairs into a dictionary that is then accessible. So we'll go over that in a little bit. Okay, so how does AJAX work? So here we have the client. Here we have the server. So, client creates AJAX object. Okay, initializes the object. Okay, and then sends object to server. Okay, so this is step one. Okay, so the request goes to the server. Server processes request. Okay, and outputs XML or plain text. So JSON is simply plain text in that hues to a certain form that can then be parsed on the client side, okay, and sends output back to client. And then step three, so this was step two, this was step one. Step three, a callback function parses output and updates web page. No state information gets lost. So on the client side, no state information gets lost. So on client side, no JavaScript state information gets lost. Another way of saying that is the JavaScript program continues to execute and retains all of its state information as long as a new web page is not loaded. As soon as a new web page is loaded, then that JavaScript program is terminated. And a JavaScript program associated with the new page is started. So as long as you're simply executing AJAX requests, you retain all of the state information. Okay, so some sample AJAX applications. You might have an email client that is simply showing, so here, this isn't exactly one, but you have an email client that would be showing the various emails that had been sent, and as periodically it might send a request to the server asking if any new emails have been received. If so, it would add them incrementally to the web page. Now, I know this is a separate application, but you could have a email server embedded or email client embedded in a browser like Office 365. Okay, you might delete an email, and that request would be sent to the server. It would delete the email, and on the client side, you would update it. So, for example, here we have a Facebook one, so I delete it, and it would get updated on the server side as well as you're updating it on the client side. Okay, another example is incremental search. So sometimes you start typing something in. Let's say I start typing in New York Times, and in fact already it's come up with the suggestion of New York Times, Knoxville News Sentinel, NVIDIA Tegra TK1, NSF Fastlane, NCAA Women's Softball Tournament, and again, New York Times. So incremental search is an application where as you enter each key, it looks in a dictionary to see possible completions. And one way that might be implemented is to have the dictionary be on the server side. So each time a key is pressed, you would send a request to the server. The server would look up the prefix that you've entered so far in the dictionary, send back a list of possible terms, which would then be displayed to the user. Okay, another common use for AJAX is in polling, where, let's say, American Idol, you're voting for different candidates. You could increment, you could see the vote totals for the candidates. They would actually be periodically updated, say every 30 seconds. Perhaps the client is going to launch a request to the server to get the polling results, and then the server would send it back and the browser would update it. So every so often you'd see the polling results updated. You'd also be able to submit your own ballot. And finally, stock quotes. So if you have any kind of ticker coming across the page, that could very well be because the client is sending requests to the server to get information from a database, the server sends that information back, and the client is updating the web page to reflect it. So there's certainly many more such applications that can run inside the browser, but that's just a handful of the ones. So this is the specific steps that you would execute in using Java. So as I said, you make a request to the server. The user can still operate the browser and, in fact, can send in multiple requests. So one important thing about this is that there can be multiple requests outstanding. So multiple AJAX requests may be outstanding, meaning at the server. And they may be completed out of order. And the browser updated out of order. That's perfectly fine. Okay, so as I said, the server puts it into an XML object or a text string. Then it gets sent back to JavaScript, and when that happens, a notification event is triggered. So you've seen them before, like onClick and onChange. There is an event called onReadyChange that gets triggered when the request is completed, and in response to that event, you can have a callback function associated with that event, and it will start executing. As I said, the output can come back in one of three forms, plain text or XML. The plain text could either require you to do your own parsing, or it could be encoded into JSON format, in which case you would hand off the plain text to a JSON parser. Specifically, there is a module called JSON, and if you call the .parse method with the plain text string you get back, it will parse the result into a JavaScript object. And what that JSON object is, or JSON plain text is a set of key value pairs. So if we go down right there, what happens is on the server side, you create an array that consists of a set of key value pairs, and that could be recursive. So an entry in the array could itself be a subarray. So you're not just limited to a simple set of key value pairs. It can be an arbitrarily nested set of arrays and lists. Then PHP has a command called JSON encode, and when you call it on an array, it takes a dictionary or associative array as its input, and it encodes it into a text string that can then be sent back to the calling program. In fact, let's just show you what that looks like. Call it json.php. And we'll say $array equals array. We'll say Brad 10, comma Nils 20. And then in fact we'll create another one. We'll say subarray equals array. We'll just make it 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we'll have foo pointing to subarray. And now we'll just echo out JSON encode array. Okay. So you can see what we've done, just created an array, put a subarray into it. And you can see that's what's coming out. This is the text string that would be sent back. Let me put a new line character there. Okay, so you can see it sends back a text string that's just an encoded form. The JSON.parse command on the client side simply parses that into a dictionary, and now you can easily access the return values through the dictionary, which in JavaScript is what? What is a dictionary in JavaScript?
Nothing.
Well, it's not nothing. It's an object. It's a prototype instance system, so in JavaScript it's an object. It doesn't have an independent sense of a dictionary. Okay. And actually, you'll notice that before you send it back, you actually output using a header command, you send back to the browser a header that tells it that the content type is of type JSON. Notice that right here it says application/JSON. So it's saying that the type of this data is, it's in a format, it's a JSON document. So even though I'm sending it back as plain text, it's in a JSON format. Okay. So those are the three ways you can send it back. As I said, it can also come back as an XML document. We'll talk in a little bit how you might process that. Okay, so these are the steps, and now we're going to say in more detail what each of those steps do. So the first thing you need to do, remember that I said over here, you create an AJAX object, you initialize the object, and you send the object to the server. Okay, so getting the new object is typically simply making a call to something called to create an instance of something called XML HTTP request. All recent versions of browsers, Internet Explorer, Opera, Chrome, Firefox, Safari, all support this object. There are some older versions of Internet Explorer that implemented AJAX requests using ActiveX controls. As has happened in many other instances, Microsoft lost. It tried to, in effect, I think, bludgeon people into using its alternative standard, and people refused. So older versions of Internet Explorer, namely 5 and 6, used ActiveX objects. So if you really want to make sure that the XML HTTP request object exists, you first say if window dot. So window is another predefined variable for you, just like JavaScript provides the document variable. And if it exists, you get the instance of the object. Else, you check to see if there's an ActiveX object available. And if neither of those works, you indicate your browser doesn't support AJAX, which would be pretty unusual these days. So that's step one. Now you have the object. You hold the object. Now you need to open the connection. And when you open the connection, you're telling the server which script you want to call and which action, get or post, you're using to send your parameter information. So in this case, I am using get to post the request. I am calling a PHP script called search.php. And what does the question mark query equal John and type equal image denote? Those are my parameters. So after the question mark, that's the list of my parameters as key value pairs. Okay, so I can also ask for an XML document. It does not have to be a script that I'm going to execute. I could actually be asking for a XML document. Now in this case, I'm asking for it on the client side, but I could make a server-side request by giving it the full URL, and that would send back a XML document to me. Okay, so now you've initialized it. The third step is to send the request. If you are posting using GET, then you call send, and you pass null. There's nothing further to specify. You've already specified the action, the script, or the XML file, and if necessary, any parameters. If it is post, the sequence is different. With post, you don't send the parameters as part of the with the script. So here with GET you send the parameters with the script, here you don't. That means that when you do the send, that is the time when you specify the parameter string. Notice there's no question mark in this case because what's the question mark do? What's the point of the question mark? Why is there a question mark here? Delimits the start of the parameters. Well, here there's no reason. You know that it's a parameter string. Here the problem is you're combining the script with the parameters, so you need a delimiter to indicate where the name of the script ends and the parameters start. Here, you don't need the question mark because you know where the parameters start. That's the only thing in the string. Notice this thing in the middle. If you don't have this statement in the middle, the post fails. So you have to set your request header to indicate that you are posting, and this is just the line that you copy. And that tells it that the post method is being used in this request. If you fail to put this in, post fails. When you get to PHP, and you try to look in the post array, it will be uninitialized. Okay, so this is on the initiating the request. So the server munges on it, gives you some output. We'll skip that step now and go to step three, which is what we do with the output that the server creates. So first of all, once you call send, the server is going to periodically trigger this onReadyStateChange event. And it's going to trigger it is five different times. So after the request, after new has been completed, it sends the or raises the event. After open has finished, it raises the event. After send is finished, it raises the event. Once the server gets the request, it sends an acknowledgement. Hey, I got the request, I'm working on it. And finally, when the server is done and the request is complete and the response has arrived at the client. So five different times is this event raised with a single AJAX request object. And you can check the value of the ready state property. So the AJAX request object has a ready state property. And the ready state property, that is what contains those five values. So you can check the ready state change property. Typically, the only value you care about is four. The other ones you typically don't care about. Now, once the response is or request is complete, you still need to check the status field to see that it's set to 200. If it's set to 200, the request succeeded. If it's set to anything else, it failed. Okay, if it failed, your AJAX request object has a status text field that gives you an explanation of the error. Often it's pretty meaningless. Okay, it almost never tells you anything useful. But at any rate, you can print it out to see what the server had to say about it. If it succeeded, then it says okay. So you write a function to handle the response. So the first thing you typically do is check to see whether the ready state is 4. If it's not, you simply return because you're really only interested in doing something when the request is complete. Then you check to see that the status is 200. If it is, you typically call a callback function. Okay? Now, this is not a property that is predefined. Ready state is a predefined property, status is a predefined property, callback isn't. That's a property you set. You could call it anything you want. You could call it foo. But what you typically call it is callback, and you set it to a function pointer. So you can see that's what I did right here, is I set the callback equal to the name of some callback function. Okay, then if it failed, so if the text status is not 200, I'm popping up a alert box saying what the status code was and what the error message was. So very simple. Now, most of the action will take place in your callback function. That's where you're actually going to be doing the changes to the web page. So the response handler is actually just a function I wrote. It's a generic, easy-to-use function that I just associate with the onReadyStateChange event. Remember I said onReadyStateChange is the event that gets triggered. So I associate this response handler with it. Then I associate with the callback property, the callback function I want, and away it goes. So the request object, this AJAX request object, I create it right here. Okay, so I have an instance of a AJAX request. And I'm actually, before I call open and send, I set these two properties. So even though you see me setting them here, you actually set these two. So set these two properties. Before you call open. Okay, and then you have to know where the server put its response. If it sent back XML, it will be in a property called response XML, and if it sent back plain text or JSON, it will be in a property called response text. So you need to know which form the document is coming back as so that you know which property to be looking at in your callback object. Now, this is so standard that I actually created an AJAX request library that does a lot of this stuff for you. So the first In this course, we actually won't have an opportunity to write an Ajax program, but if you do, you may find this library helpful because it's very simple. It has only two methods. Only one of them is really public. So you first call Ajax request. You give it the action, post or get, the URL of the script or the XML file, your parameter string, and the callback function that you want. And it returns an Ajax object to you with all the fields properly initialized. And then you can simply call your, yes, it actually sends it. So here's the function. You can see that it gets the Ajax object, then it sets the ready state change, and callback functions. If it's a get, it opens and sends it. If it's a post, it opens, set the request header, and sends it. And then finally it returns it. So when it comes back, you actually already have posted the request. And then there's an internal function called Ajax response, which you never even touch. And that simply is handling the response. Ajax response is simply this response handler that's calling the callback. And your callback function, if you need to pass it parameters, you'll notice that the callback function doesn't get any parameters. Yet you really may need it to have parameters. The way that you can give it parameters is to add properties to the Ajax request object. So if then you can't use my library, unfortunately. So it is what it is. But if you need, I'll say parameters passed to the request object or to the callback function, you can do one of two things. Okay, we'll do this first. You can, one, add properties to the Ajax request object. Or two, you can execute the function callback function inside the inside another JavaScript function. So to show you what I mean by that. So then you have any local variable declared in that JavaScript function will be available to your callback function. So let me show you in CodeAssessor. Okay, so here you can see that what I'm doing is I get my request object, then I actually define my function inside the scope of another function, and therefore my function, since it's nested within another function, this anonymous function right here, it's an anonymous function, has access to all the local variables that are declared in the outer function. So that's the other way that you can quote pass parameters to it. So this function is aware of all the context in the enclosing function. Okay, you can't do this in C or C++ because you can't put a function inside another function, but you can in JavaScript. So that's a handy thing to be able to do. Okay, so in this case, I wasn't using my JavaScript library because I needed additional information. You could, after you get the request object back, you could call, you could say foo equals Ajax request dot dot dot, and then you could try to say foo dot say some param equals dot dot dot, and in all likelihood that parameter would get set before the callback is called because the server has to make a round trip. So in all likelihood, this would set the parameter, but you can't be 100% sure of it. So in certain situations, the callback could get executed before param gets set. Okay. So questions about that? Okay, we've talked about changing content already, talked about returning JSON objects. If you want to return a XML document from the server, then you need to make sure, first of all, that you are telling the browser that the content type is XML. So again, you're calling the header command. You can see now the content type is text XML. That tells the browser to put the response into the response XML property rather than the response text property. Then you save, you presumably have some kind of XML document that you've been processing. In this case, I assume that you are using the DOM parser in PHP. And so you echo out, you echo whatever output you want sent to the client, that anything you put in an echo or a print command, that will be sent to the client in the order that you echo stuff out. So essentially, anything you write to standard out will be sent to the client in either the response text or response XML property. Okay? So pretty easy to send back the XML. Okay. So to tie it all together, I actually wrote a little interactive quiz program that the idea is initially it's just sitting there. You can start the quiz, and when you hit that button, it goes to the server and it's getting a test question. In fact, let's take a look at the question XML file. So here's the XML file. You can see that it has a series of questions that start with Q. It has the text of the question, a series of choices, and the correct answer, the numerically correct answer. So in this case, test is correct. Okay, so this is the, in this case, what I want is an XML document being sent to the client. So when I start the quiz, it's parsing that XML document. It's getting the question, filling in the answers. I try something like exec, submit it, pops up a box that says correct, and then you can see that it's updated it with the next question. If I miss it, so let's say you simply use it and submit it, says incorrect, the correct answer is var. Do the last one. It's a bug, that shouldn't be selected. I thought I'd fixed it, but it should be open. And correct, and then it says you scored 2 out of 3 for the quiz. So it's been keeping track of the number of answers that I got correct, as well as how many answers or how many questions were. So the whole time it had to keep a hold of some state information. Okay, so if we look at the code for the quiz file, you can see we start by defining two global variables, which is the question number, QN, and the number that I have gotten correct. You'll see in a moment what answer field is, and then I have a variable for my AJAX request. So the first thing I need to do, this is wrong. There we go. It was cached wrong. So I have a function, initialize page. When the page is loaded, I am setting up certain associating functions with certain events. So I have get questions, and you can see here I have a function called get questions. So I'm simply in the document, I'm associating certain functions with different events. And you can see if you look at the source, let's go and look at the source. You'll see that. Darn it. That's also getting a cached. Huh. There we go. So you'll see that the body says onload equals initialize page. You'll see up here that in my header, I'm loading my AJAX library, which is ajax.js, and I'm also loading my, this actually should say quiz.js right now. That's why things aren't working quite right. Let me change that. Just wondering why it was a little bit off. So it's loading these two files, then onload, it's calling the initialize page function. Now we'll go back. You'll see that we're setting up our radio buttons so that they have name, answer, value, A, B, C, and D. Initially, they're all disabled, and their IDs are answer A, answer B, answer C, answer D. So if you go back, look at the quiz file again. What this is really doing is allowing me to access the 4 radio buttons. And let's go to the quiz again. So what has to happen is when I start the quiz, those radio buttons have to be filled in. Okay, so the first thing I do is I need to load the questions from the file. So the document has a, let's see, the way the HTML thing is set up, the question field has a question ID, and the answer fields, they have the answer A, answer B, answer C, answer D. So I need to fill those fields with appropriate information. So I am initially, just when I click it, saying please wait, because there's a time when the server is processing the request and has not yet responded. So we want the user to know that something is happening, and when the request gets actually fulfilled, then we'll change that inner HTML to be the text of the question. Here, I am getting the document, which in this case is questions.xml, and there is no script associated with it, and my callback function is next question. So when the questions are loaded, it now executes this function, and you can see that it's coming back in the response.xml field, and it's already been parsed for me. So there's already a pointer to a DOM object. So the response.xml is a pointer to an XML DOM object. And I am getting all of the questions. So you'll remember there were three questions. So I'm getting all the elements with a tag of Q. So if we go back here, if you look at there's a whole bunch of Q tags. So we're getting the elements associated with these Q tags here. Then what we want is to get from the document, from the HTML document, we get the question element. Now we check to see whether the question number is less than the question's length, because we want to know whether the quiz is done or not. After we have answered all three questions, the quiz is done. So if the quiz is still ongoing, we fill in the question field. So based on the question number, we ask for the text information. So if you go over here, what we're asking for is this question text information. Then we set that question element's inner HTML to be that question. And notice that I can use the inner HTML for the HTML DOM, but for the XML DOM object, I have to use firstchild.node value. So inner HTML is not defined on the XML DOM side. So inner XHTML is not defined for the XML DOM object. This can get confusing because you're dealing with two different DOM objects. You're dealing with the XML DOM object to extract question information, and you're dealing with the HTML DOM object to modify the web page so that the question information is placed into the web page. Okay, then we're going to fill in the choices, the radio buttons associated with each of the choices. So now we get the choice tags. Okay, if you go back, you see each problem has a number of choice tags. So we're getting the choice tags now for each index and answer field. So if you remember, answer fields allows us to get access to each of the four radio buttons. Each of the four radio buttons is identified by one of those tags. Okay, so index will go 0, 1, 2, and 3. And it allows us to this statement. So this statement right there, get a pointer to the radio button. Okay, then this step right here is setting the radio button. Set the radio button's text. To the choice text. And these two are disabling, are turning off the disabling, because now we want to, so this one right here enables the radio button. And this makes sure that it's no longer checked. Okay, that was the problem I was having earlier with open still being checked. It wasn't supposed to be. Okay, so that fills in the answer and the question text. And then this part right here handles the case where the quiz is done. So if we get to this point, quiz is done. So I'm saying that there's no more questions. So I fill in the question element to say no more questions. And I pop up the alert box to indicate the number that were correct and the out of however many questions there were. Okay, so this was important. The numCorrect was a global variable. I had to maintain its state information the whole time, so I could not keep reloading the page. Okay, and then finally, check answer is getting called by the submit button. So over here, whoops, when I hit submit, down here, when I get the submit, I get the submit button when I load the page, and I set it's on click to be check answer. So whenever I hit the submit button, it calls check answer. Okay, and it's again pulling in the question. So this one is getting get the Q elements from the XML document. Okay, this one is now extract the answer. From the XML document. And if you look, you'll see that there's an answer tag. Okay, so then what is happening is the answers come back, and even though there's only one answer, you don't XML doesn't know that. So even though you know there's only one answer, the answers come back in an array. So the answer comes back in a one-element array. So we're extracting now. This had a pointer, so this step where it says extract the answer for the XML document, what it's really doing is get pointers to the answer, or get a pointer. The answer element. And this next step, so this is step one, this is step two, step three, extract the text of the answer. And store it in correct. Okay, now I want to find out which answer was selected. Okay, so A, B, C, or D. And I could, so correct choice actually is coming back. Remember, answer is a number. So what we're doing is we're going to try to make sure that the index of the selected answer is the same as the number of the answer. So step four is find the index of the user's selected answer. And see if it is the same as the index of the correct answer. So we're using the with form there to iterate through the form and find the index. Now, I could write this loop differently. How could I also write that loop in JavaScript more succinctly? If on a test, I gave you that loop and I said, write that loop more succinctly. Yes, take a crack. Yes. In this case, it's 4n, but I think it's 4n. Ah, this is where I get. This is awful where you get. Yes, it is 4n. So I could have said 4 index in answer. And it would have had the same, would have been the same. You can tell that I wrote this a number of years ago when I was less experienced in JavaScript. It's interesting. Yesterday I went back and I updated the code, but I didn't catch that for statement. There were some other improvements I made based on the fact that I'm a more experienced JavaScript programmer these days. Okay, so then, if the user got the correct answer, I increment num correct and pop up an alert message. Otherwise, what I need to do is I need to find the actual text associated with the correct answer. So if I miss it, okay, what I'm doing is retrieving the text for the correct answer. So I'm finding all of the choices. So this one right here, find all the choices or get pointers to all the choice elements. In the XML document. Associate it with this question. So that's going to return an array. So step two is going to be to extract the text, associate it with the correct answer. And then step three, so that's just indexing into the choices array and getting the text associated with the correct choice. And then three, I pop up the alert box saying what the correct answer is. Then I update the question number so that I point to the next question number. And I clear the, again, I cleared the answer box. And that's why I was still a little unsure why there was that open was checked, so I'm still not exactly sure. There still seems to be a bug in the program. This is supposed to clear, should clear the previously checked radio button. And for some reason, that statement doesn't seem to always be working. I'm not sure why. But it should. Okay. And then we call next question, which fills in the fields for the next question. Okay. So that kind of, I know that was rather involved, but it really does show you, it ties together everything we've been talking about. So it shows you how an AJAX request works. It shows you also how you can use JavaScript to modify the HTML DOM to update a web page. It shows you how you can associate functions with events. Okay. It even shows you a sample XML document and how you can store simple things in an XML document rather than necessarily storing them in a database. So it really does bring together a lot of what we talked about in the last 4 weeks of the course. It brings together the XML component. It brings the XML DOM component, the JavaScript DOM component, and the ability to do AJAX requests. Now, I know that we did not. I used to have a homework assignment where you vote it for your favorite color. So it used to be that in class we did, in fact, do an example where you were able to vote for your favorite color. The problem was this particular exercise takes a couple hours to do. And I used to allot one class session to do it, and it just turned out to be not feasible to do. And in addition to that, you obviously don't have time to do one last homework assignment on it. Although that's not really true, is it? I'm not going to assign it, but don't some professors make stuff due like Wednesday or Thursday? I'm not going to do it, so. Pardon? What? Oh, in lieu of a final, I say. So, at any rate, that's what that comment was. I have to get rid of that comment because we don't do it anymore. So, on the test, I won't expect you, on the test, I will only expect you to write Perl programs. But on the test, I will expect you to be able to recognize how to do appropriate JavaScript and PHP programs. Like I said, if an example question could have been for JavaScript, an example question could be, here's this loop. And then I might give you four choices and say which of those answers is a simpler way to write this loop in JavaScript. And I might be nasty and show you the Perl way of doing it, and the PHP way of doing it, and the Java way of doing it, and the JavaScript way of doing it. So you will have to be able to recognize which is which. Okay? So, in fact, PHP has a for as, which is wrong, and I believe Perl has a for each, which is wrong, and JavaScript has a for in, which is right. Okay? So you may have to do some JavaScript code fragments, and in fact, on today's quiz, today is the last quiz, there is one, but today's quiz has a couple problems like that where you do very simple JavaScript code fragments to solve some problems. Okay, so remember, 5 o'clock today, your last homework is done. Hopefully it's already done so you can relax the rest of the afternoon, but if not, it's due at 5. There's no late submissions. The homework solutions appear at 5:01, so please don't send me an email begging for an extra hour. You won't get it. And I will see you 12:30 on Friday, looking bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. If not, bring caffeine. Okay? I'll see you Friday.